Okay, I hope I'm audible to all students who are attending this lecture of International Economics. We intend to start with the first topic within our lectures on International Economics. This is the Ricardian model of labor productivity and comparative advantage. Okay, and the book I prefer to follow for my lectures on the Ricardian model, okay, this is chapter 3. Of the book International Economics by Krugman and Mellitz. This is the book I prefer to follow for my lectures on international economics. And in this particular lecture, we are starting with the first topic, which is the Ricardian model of comparative advantage and labor productivity. The reference for this lecture is chapter 3 of Krugman and Mellitz. Okay, so in this particular lecture, we intend to look at a very important concept, which is called as comparative advantage. It is a very important concept within our lectures on international economics. So when do we say that a country is having a comparative advantage in production of a good? So let's look at the definition of comparative advantage. A country is said to have a comparative advantage in producing a good if the opportunity cost of producing that good in terms of other good is lower in that country than in other countries. So very simple. Any economy is going to have a comparative advantage in production of a good if the opportunity cost of producing that good in terms of some other good is lower in that country as compared to some other country. Okay, let's understand this concept in a much better way by taking the example. I have taken the same example which Krugman and Mellitz take. Okay, suppose we talk about the US economy. Okay, and suppose the US currently grows 10 million roses for sale, and these resources used to grow roses could also have been used to produce 100,000 computers. So we have taken an arbitrary example where the resources of US can either be put to making 10 million roses or they can be used for making 100,000 computers. So given the definition of opportunity cost, which all of us have done in our lectures in introductory microeconomics, the opportunity cost of 10 million roses is the 100,000 computers which could have been produced. That means if the US economy is devoting its resources to make 10 million roses, it is sacrificing 100,000 computers which could have been made using those resources. But suppose resources can be more easily grown in Colombia and that the Colombian workers are less efficient than the US workers in producing computers. Now suppose we take the case where the US resources are more suited or efficient in producing computers and the Colombian resources are more efficient or suited to producing roses. Okay, so if you look at both the above statements, they imply what they imply, that the opportunity cost of roses in terms of computers would be less in Colombia as compared to you. Since Colombian workers are more efficient in making roses as compared to computers, the opportunity cost of roses in terms of computers would be less. That means the Colombian workers, in order to produce more roses, will have to give up less of computers. Because anyways, the Colombian workers do not have expertise in computers. They have expertise in roses. That means the Colombian workers can produce a lot of roses just by giving a little bit of computers. On the other hand, if you look at the US, the US workers are more suited to producing computers. So I can say that the opportunity cost of computers in terms of roses is less in US. Because the US workers can produce a lot of computers just by sacrificing a little bit of rose production. So if I come to the whiteboard to explain this, okay, the example we have taken to understand the concept of comparative advantage is that we have taken the example of the US economy. US workers versus Colombian workers. So the US workers are relatively more efficient. When I say relatively, I'm doing a comparison with the Colombian workers. So the US workers are relatively more efficient in production of computers and the Colombian workers are relatively more efficient. They are relatively more efficient in production of roses. So what does this mean? I can write this means that the US workers can produce a lot of computers just by sacrificing some of the rose production. The US workers can produce a lot of computers just by sacrificing some of the rose production. The Colombian workers, it means what? This means that the Colombian workers can produce a lot of roses. They can produce a lot of roses just by sacrificing some of the computer production. Okay, so this is what we understand from the example. And suppose I can now write the opportunity cost. Okay, so I am writing the opportunity cost now. So I erase the initial part and I can write the opportunity cost. So if I talk about the US workers, okay, so the US workers can either use their resources. The US workers can use their resources either to produce 10 million roses or 100,000 computers. Okay. On the other hand, the Colombian workers can use their labor or resources either to produce 10 million roses or only 30,000 computers. So guys, what do we learn? The opportunity cost of roses is 30,000 computers in Colombia and 100,000 computers in US. That means the Colombian workers can produce the same 10 million roses only by giving up 30,000 computers. But the US workers have to produce 10 million roses by giving up 100,000 worth of computers. So what do we learn? So if I write, I can write, therefore, the opportunity cost of producing roses is less in Colombia as compared to US. This is what we learn. The opportunity cost of producing roses The Colombian workers can produce 10 million doses by just giving up 30,000 computers. On the other hand, the US workers can produce 10 million doses by giving up 100,000 computers. That means Colombian workers have a lower opportunity cost. So I can say, therefore, Colombian workers have a comparative advantage in production of roses. So if I erase this off, I can make the table. The table is going to make it crystal clear. Okay, roses, which are measured in millions, and computers, which are measured in thousands. Okay, this is US economy. This is Colombian economy. Now, clearly, what did we learn? The US economy can produce 10 million roses or 100,000 computers. The Colombian economy can produce 10 million roses or 30,000 computers. So I can say clearly, Colombia has a comparative advantage. Colombia has a comparative advantage in the rose production. Since it has to sacrifice less of computer production, since it has to sacrifice less of computer production compared to US, to produce the same 10 million roses. Or students can see this. The Colombian economy has to sacrifice only 30,000 computers as compared to the US economy to produce the same 10 million roses. That means Colombia has a comparative advantage because the opportunity cost of roses in terms of computers is less in Colombia as compared to US. So if we let both the economies trade, what should US do? The US should only focus on making computers. So US should not make roses at all. So minus 10, US should not devote roses to 10. And US should devote all its resources to all the 100,000. The US should devote all its resources to making computers, thus making 100,000 computers, and should not devote any resource to making roses. On the other hand, the Colombian economy has a comparative advantage in making roses. So the Colombian economy should devote all its resources to making 10 million roses and should not devote any resource to making computers. That means the US economy has an advantage in making computers. The US economy should specialize in computer production. The Colombian economy has a comparative advantage in making roses. The Colombian economy should devote all its resources to making roses. Now, if we talk about the world as a whole, suppose the world consists of only US and Colombia, hypothetically. Just to make the model simple, suppose the world only consists of two economies, US and Colombia. What is happening? The 10 million roses given up by US are exactly balanced by Colombia, leading to zero change. But when they specialize in their own respective areas, you can see that the world as a whole is going to have 70,000 extra computers. The world as a whole is going to have 70,000 extra computers. So what do we learn? If both the economies, US and Colombia, specialize in that commodity in which they have a comparative advantage, the world as a whole is going to gain from it. Even though there is no change in the rose production from the point of view of the world economy, because The 10 million roses given up by US are exactly balanced by 10 million roses produced by Colombia. But if you look at computers, the world as a whole is gaining. Since US has a comparative advantage in producing computers, it only devotes all its resources to making computers, making 100,000 computers. Since Colombia does not have a comparative advantage in making computers, it devotes all its resources to making roses, giving up 30,000 worth of computers. The world as a whole is gaining 100,000 computers, but losing 30,000 computers. In net terms, the world as a whole is gaining 70,000 computers. So when economies specialize in that commodity in which they have a comparative advantage, the world as a whole is going to gain from it. Okay, so if I quickly come back to the lecture note, students can clearly see I've drawn the same table which I had drawn on the whiteboard. Okay, and then if you read the explanation part, this difference in the opportunity cost offers the possibility of mutually benefiting from trade. Okay, suppose US stops growing roses and devotes all resources to producing computers. And suppose Colombia devotes all resources to the production of roses and no computers. Then clearly from the above table, you can see that the world as a whole is producing zero roses, but 70,000 computers. So the world is producing just as many roses as before. That means there is no change. It does not mean that the world is producing zero roses. It simply means that there is no change. Because US gives up 10 million roses and Colombia adds up 10 million roses. So the change in rose production is zero. This is nothing but the change in rose production. And this is also nothing but change in computer production. So students should not think that the rose production is zero. Rose production is not zero. Change in rose production is zero. Similarly, 70 does not denote computer production. It denotes change in computer production. Okay, so our students can see the world is producing just as many roses as before because the change in rose production is zero, but is now producing more computers. With this rearrangement of production, the world as a whole is producing more. And if the world as a whole is producing more, it is going to raise everyone's standard of living. Very simple. If the size of the cake goes up, everyone is going to benefit from it. So if the size of the commodities, if we talk about the world economy as a whole, if the production of any commodity goes up, it's going to benefit everyone in the economy. So we can clearly see the reason why international trade increases the world output is that, here comes the main line, it allows each country to specialize in the production of that good in which that particular country is going to have a comparative advantage. So the reason for motivation for having international trade, this is actually a motivation for having international trade, is that when every economy is going to specialize in the production of that commodity in which that economy has a comparative advantage, then in that particular case, you will see that the world output is going to increase, which is going to benefit the entire economies involved. So we can say trade between two countries can benefit both the countries if each country is going to export that good in which it has a comparative advantage. So when the US and the Colombian economy are going to trade with each other, US is going to export computers because it has a comparative advantage in production of computers. Colombia, on the other hand, is going to export roses because Colombia has a comparative advantage in production of roses, as we have seen in the example. When both the economies are going to export that commodity in which they have a comparative advantage, not only do they benefit, the world as a whole is also going to benefit from it. So hoping all students have understood this particular theory of comparative advantage and have no doubts. Okay, now let's continue with the Ricardian model. Let's go deeper into the Ricardian model. Okay, so David Ricardo, who introduced the concept of comparative advantage in the 19th century, explained that the international trade is solely due to international differences in the productivity of labor. All the terms which I am circling in the lecture, they are the very important terms. So David Ricardo in his model is going to explain that why does international trade occur? International trade occurs solely because of the reason that different economies have different productivities of labor. And every economy is going to specialize in production of that commodity which has higher productivity of labor. We just saw in the above example that Colombian workers are more productive in making roses. US workers are more productive in making computers. So the Colombian economy specializes in rose production and the US economy specializes in computer production. That is why, guys, the trade is happening. The motivation for having international trade, as explained by Ricardo, is that different economies have different productivities of labor, and it is the difference in the productivities of labor which enables the economies to specialize in the production of their respective commodities, which creates a motivation for the economies to trade. If all the economies have the same productivity of labor, then there will be no trade. If the US economy is equally efficient in making roses and computers, and the Colombian economy is also equally efficient in making roses and computers, why will they trade at the first place? They are happy. The reason that they are trading with each other is because one economy has workers who have higher productivity in rose production, another economy has workers who have higher productivity in computer production. And that is what makes them trade. Otherwise, they will not trade with each other. Okay. So if I now go into the depth of this model, let's involve some microeconomics in this. So we are going to the micro application of this model now. So let's look at the one factor economy. We are going to go to two factors and multiple factors in the coming lectures. But in this particular lecture, we only focus on one factor. So every economy is going to have one factor of production. Let's call it as labor. So there are two economies. Consider an economy which we call in our analysis as the home country. That has only one factor of production. Let's call that one factor of production as labor for simplicity. And suppose that there are two goods that are produced. We call them as wine and cheese. I am taking exactly the same goods which Krugman and Meritz take in their analysis. Okay. So the technology of the home's economy can be summarized or expressed in terms of the unit labor requirement. Now, what will unit labor requirement capture? It will capture the hours of labor, number of hours of labor required to produce 1 pound of cheese or a gallon of wine. Cheese is measured in pounds and wine is measured in gallons. Okay, so quickly revising, we have the home economy or the home country. There is only one factor of production, call it labor. There are two goods, wine and cheese. Wine is measured in gallons. Cheese is measured in pounds. We talk about the technology of the home economy characterized by the unit labor requirement, which is going to show us the number of hours of labor needed to produce a pound of cheese or a gallon of wine. So let's look at these notations. ALW denotes the unit labor requirement in wine. That means ALW is going to capture how many hours of labor is required to produce. How many hours of labor is required to produce a gallon of wine. ALC is going to capture the unit labor requirement in cheese. That means how many hours of labor is required to produce 1 pound of cheese. And L denotes the total labor supply in the home economy. Okay, so hoping students have understood this. I can quickly write this to sum it up on the whiteboard. Okay, so we have the home economy producing two commodities, cheese in pounds and wine in gallons. Okay, and then we have these terms. ALW is the unit labor requirement. Is the unit labor requirement in production of wine. That means how many hours of labor are required to produce 1 gallon of wine. I can write hours of labor required to produce 1 gallon of wine. And then, guys, we have ALC, which is the unit labor requirement. Unit labor requirement in the production of cheese. Where I can write hours of labor required to produce 1 pound of cheese. Hours of labor required to produce 1 pound of cheese. L denotes the total labor supply in the economy. Now, all of us know the concept of budget lines in microeconomics. We have done this in the introductory microeconomics course. If I draw the budget line, so I can write W denotes the total wine production. And C denotes the total cheese. I can write it like this, guys. Let me correct myself. QW denotes the total wine production in the home economy, or I can say the home country. And QC denotes the total cheese production in the home country. So if I look at the production possibilities, can I quickly draw the total production in the economy? What is the total product? What is the total labor required? Okay. ALW denotes the labor required to produce 1 gallon of wine. So to produce QW gallons of wine, how much labor you require? You require ALW. You require ALW times QW. So I can write it like this basically. I can write ALW times QW is the total labor in wine production. I'm revising this again. ALW denotes the hours of labor required to produce 1 gallon of wine. So by unitary method in maths, to produce QW gallons of wine, you need ALW into QW hours of labor. So this is total labor in hours in the wine production. And similarly, guys, ALC into QC is the total labor in hours in cheese production. ALC denotes the hours of labor to produce 1 pound of cheese. To produce QC pounds of cheese, by unitary method, you require how much labor? ALC into QC. So now comes our constraint, that total labor in the cheese production plus total labor in the wine production should be less than equal to the total labor supply in the economy. This is nothing but total labor in cheese production. This is nothing but total labor in wine production. Total labor in wine production, and this is nothing but the total labor supply in the home economy. Clearly, you can see it resembles like the budget constraint in microeconomics. Okay, so Now all of us know how to plot it. So if I plot it, so I can write at the equality, I have ALCQC plus ALWQW equal to L. What is my horizontal intercept? My horizontal intercept, how will I find it, guys? Okay, first of all, cheese is measured on the horizontal axis. You can think of it as the X good, and wine is measured on the vertical axis. You can think of it as the Y good in our analysis. Okay, cheese is measured on the X axis, wine is measured on the Y axis. So my horizontal intercept, how will I find it? Put QW equal to 0, which implies my QC will be equal to L upon ALC. And what is the horizontal intercept going to capture? It is going to capture the maximum amount of cheese the economy can produce. The maximum amount of cheese the economy can produce. Okay, if it devotes all resources to cheese production. This is my interpretation of the horizontal intercept. Maximum amount of cheese the economy can produce if it devotes all its resources to cheese production. What is my vertical intercept going to capture? How will I calculate the vertical intercept? Put QC as 0, which implies QW is equal to L upon ALW. This denotes the maximum amount of wine that the economy can produce if it devotes all its resources to the wine production. If it denotes all its resources to the wine production. And if I, guys, quickly calculate the slope, what will the slope be now? So if I erase this off now, we have found out the horizontal intercept. We have found out the vertical intercept. If I quickly calculate the slope, I erase the initial part now. What will my slope be? So slope will be equal to dQW by dQC. Guys, QW is measured on the vertical axis and QC is measured on the horizontal axis. From basic maths, recall, what is my slope? It's nothing but dy by dx. What is measured on the y-axis? QW. What is measured on the x-axis? QC. So from this particular equation, can I quickly calculate dQW by dQC? Okay. So we have, if I write ALWQW is equal to L minus ALCQC. Basically, this term, I took it to the right-hand side, which implies my QW is equal to L upon ALW minus ALC by ALW times QC. This is the equation I have. You can see I have written my equation in terms of QW in terms of QC. So can I quickly differentiate this with respect to QC? So dQW by dQC will be equal to minus ALC by ALW. This is nothing but my slope of this production possibility curve. Okay, it's nothing but a production possibility curve. And you can see that it's constant. If you look at the slope, it's constant. So it's downward sloping and constant. And if the slope is downward sloping and constant, it means my production possibility curve is a straight line. So if I quickly erase this off now, and if I draw the production possibility curve for all students, Let us see how it's going to look like. So remember, we are assuming that ALC and ALW, the unit labor requirements, they are constant. And if they are constant, the slope we have just got, so I can write the slope of the production possibility frontier. The slope of the production possibility frontier is equal to minus ALC by ALW. Okay, since the slope is negative, I can write that my PPF is downward sloping and since slope is constant, because ALC and ALW both are constant, so since my slope is constant, PPF is a straight line. So it's a downward sloping straight line. So if I erase this off and if I draw the diagram, it's going to look like this. On the x-axis, we have quantity of cheese production. On the y-axis, quantity of wine production. You have a downward sloping production possibility frontier. Your horizontal intercept gives you the maximum amount of cheese production which the economy can have when all resources are used to produce cheese. The vertical intercept gives you the maximum amount of wine production you can have given all resources are used for production of wine. This is your, I can write PF denotes my production possibility frontier. This is nothing but my production possibility frontier. And the slope of this is nothing but minus ALC by ALW. Okay, so I can quickly come back to the lecture note. I can discuss this on the from the lecture note also. You can see the diagram which we have drawn on the whiteboard, the same diagram you can see on your screen. In the above diagram, home production of cheese is shown on the x-axis. Home production of wine is shown on the y-axis. PF denotes the production possibility frontier, which shows the maximum amount of wine that can be produced once the decision has been made to produce any given amount of cheese and vice versa. Okay, so since the labor is the only factor of production, PPF is simply a straight line. Remember, guys, we are going to have diminishing marginal productivities when we have two factors. In microeconomics, we have learned that in the short run, one of the factors is fixed. So the other factor starts exhibiting diminishing returns. But in this particular analysis, we have only assumed that you only have one factor of production, which is labor, and that is having constant returns. That means every time to produce one more pound of cheese or one more gallon of wine, you require ALC or ALW hours of labor every time. Okay, so QW denotes the economy's production of wine, QC denotes the economy's production of cheese. Then the labor used in producing wine is ALW, QW, labor used in producing cheese is ALC, QC. This is by unitary method in mathematics. The economy's total labor supply is L, so our production possibilities are characterized by this inequality. Total labor in cheese production plus total labor in wine production should be less than or equal to total labor supply. Now, I have taken an example which explains this. Suppose my total labor supply is 1,000. Suppose ALC is equal to 1. How do I interpret this? It means 1 hour of labor is required to produce 1 pound of cheese. ALW is equal to 2. That means 2 hours of labor is required to produce 1 gallon of wine. So if I substitute it in the main equation, QC plus 2QW is equal to 1,000. Because L is 1,000, ALW is 2, and ALC is 1. We can quickly calculate. You can see it's similar to the budget line. It is similar to the budget constraint in micro. Okay. Although it's a production possibility, this is nothing but the production possibility set. Actually, it is a production possibility set because it's giving you combinations of cheese and wine the economy can produce. But all students who have done microeconomics can very well spot that the production possibility set here is looking similar to the budget constraint in micro. If the economy devotes all its labor to cheese production, how much cheese can it produce? L upon ALC. L is 1,000, ALC is 1, that means 1,000 pounds of cheese. And if the economy devotes all its labor to wine production, it can produce L upon ALW. L is 1,000, ALW is 2. 1,000 by 2 is 500 gallons of wine. So the maximum amount of cheese the economy can produce given its resources is 1,000 pounds of cheese. The maximum amount of wine the economy can produce given its resources is 500 gallons of wine. Or the economy can also produce any mix of wine and cheese that lies on the straight line connecting the two extremes. Remember, 1,000 is your horizontal intercept, which is one extreme. 500 is your vertical intercept, which is another extreme. This is your horizontal intercept. This is your vertical intercept. But the economy can also produce a combination of them. Okay, so if we quickly look at the note, then the production possibility frontier is a straight line. The opportunity cost of a pound of cheese in terms of wine is constant. That means nothing but your slope. Your slope is nothing but the opportunity cost of a pound of cheese in terms of wine. That is constant. And you can see we have used the unitary method. To produce one more pound of cheese requires ALC labor hours. Okay, so you can clearly see ALW labor hours are used to produce 1 gallon of wine. So one labor hour is used to produce 1 upon ALW gallons of wine. So ALC labor hours will be used to produce ALC by ALW, which is nothing but the opportunity cost of cheese in terms of wine. Okay. So clearly in our example, you can see that ALC is 1. In our example, and ALW is 2. So my slope here is nothing but half. Okay. To produce every pound of cheese, the economy has to give up half a gallon of wine. Okay. So you can clearly see that this opportunity cost is equal to the absolute value of the slope of the production possibility front. So guys, if I talk about the slope is nothing but what? The slope of the production possibility frontier is nothing but the opportunity cost of a pound of cheese in terms of wine. And you can see, we have just used the unitary method to derive. ALW labor hours are required to produce 1 gallon of wine. So one labor hour is required to produce 1 upon ALW gallons of wine. So ALC labor hours are required to produce ALC by ALW gallons of wine. Okay, so this is nothing but your opportunity cost of cheese in terms of wine. And what does opportunity cost of cheese in terms of wine give you? It tells you how much wine, how many gallons of wine you need to sacrifice to produce one more pound of cheese. Okay, so since your ALC is 1 and your ALW is 2, your opportunity cost is nothing but to produce every pound of cheese, you have to give up half a gallon of wine. I can write this on the whiteboard also. If I come to the whiteboard, I can write the slope of the production possibility frontier is nothing but the opportunity. Is nothing but the opportunity cost of cheese in terms of wine, which is nothing but ALC by ALW in absolute terms. I am ignoring the minus sign for the time being. Minus sign just denotes the fact that the PPF is downward slope. But the slope of the production possibility frontier captures the opportunity cost of cheese in terms of wine, which is nothing but ALC by ALW. I can write, suppose the ALC by ALW comes out as half. So I can write, this means that the economy has to give up half a gallon of wine for production of 1 more pound of cheese. This is how we can interpret the slope. That means if the economy decides to produce 1 more pound of cheese, it has to give up 1/2 gallon of wine for that production. Okay, so guys, this is where I intend to stop in this particular lecture. The objective was to introduce to all students the Ricardian model of comparative advantage. Okay, now in the next lecture, we'll continue with this model in the next lecture, and we'll talk about the relative prices and supply from the next lecture onwards. From the next lecture onwards, we will be focusing on the same model of Ricardo. We'll talk about the relative prices and the supply. In this lecture, we have talked about the production possibilities. We'll introduce relative prices and supply in the next lecture of International Trade. So I hope all students have enjoyed this lecture. Any doubt, you can unmute your mics and ask, or call up or mail me your doubts at divineschooloficonomics@gmail.com. So this is where I stop in this lecture.